Stretch your hands toward right now and say, God, fill her up to overflowing. Thank you for that anointing from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Celine, bless the Lord. Amen.
I said, I'm tired of the chain, but I Hallelujah. When you know that you know that God has done something in your life. Hallelujah.
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 That's all right.
Yes,
I'm going to tell you my secret. He know I'm. I said all the time. Sister Sadie, I know I can change.
Amen. 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 Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you for your Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
We thank you, Lord, that you thought enough of us to come and visit with us. And now, Lord, touch me that I may speak boldly those things that you have given me to speak. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. This morning, we're going to talk about the other side of through. Amen. Anybody ever been going along in your life, you're following God, or maybe you just recently gave your life to Christ, but nonetheless, things seem to be going okay, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, with no warning, the bottom drops out, and everything starts to go haywire. Nothing seems to be going right. The progress you were making has just been wiped out. So many tragic things can happen. I don't really need to start naming them. We all have them, and we're all intimately familiar with them, so I don't really need to remind you. But well, if you've been in the church for any length of time, you've heard about a man named Job and how bad things went for him one day. I'm going to talk about Job for just a bit today, and I'm going to tell you why no matter how bad things may get, you have to keep going. Because your blessing is on the other side of through.
Amen.
That's important to remember when all you really want to do is lay in bed with the blinds drawn, the doors closed, and the lights off. Anybody been there, or am I just the only one? Right? Our scripture text is in the last chapter of Job, but before we get there, I want to give you the beginning of the story. We're going to do it a little different. Okay, Job's story begins, of course, in Job 1. We're telling you who Job is, and that is what is, and this is what it says. He lived in the land of Uz. He was blameless, a man of complete integrity. He feared God, stayed away from evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, and 500 female donkeys. He had many servants. He was, in fact, the richest person in the entire area. Job had it going on. He didn't bother anybody. He took care of his family, and he was the spiritual leader of his household. He made sure his children were covered after they had one of their parties that sometimes lasted for days. He would offer a sacrifice to God for each one of his children. So Job is going along, minding his own business, when up in heaven, Satan shows up in front of God with the other angels, and God asks him, "Where'd you come from?" To which Satan responds, "Oh, I've been roaming about the earth, watching what's going on." He still roams today, y'all.
Amen.
Satan walks around seeing who he can devour. And what do you think he's looking for? Well, let me tell you. Anyone ever watch those nature shows where the lioness are out hunting for food and they come across a herd of animals grazing? The first thing they do is they stay low and out of sight so they don't spook their prey. Then they look for an opening, a sign of weakness in the group. It may be a young one, an injured one, or an old one. Then they attack, methodically separating them from the group. You see, when you're alone, you're an easy target. The lioness act as one unit, and together they bring down prey much larger than themselves, and their actions result in dinner for the pride of lions. You're no different. Satan is looking to destroy you. He comes but to kill, to steal, and to destroy you. He starts by sneaking up on you, watching and listening to what you say. You see, your words have power, And what you charge the atmosphere with is what Satan will use against you. But here's the good news. It's also what God will use for you. If you're not already, you'd better start speaking life to your situation.
Amen.
But Satan wants to separate you from the pack. That would be other Christians, specifically your church family. He whispers lies like, stay home today. They don't really need you there. But the truth is, we need everyone every Sunday. And more importantly, you need to be here every Sunday. Why? Because the Word of God saves lives. It's food when you're hungry. Jesus is the bread of life. Water when you're thirsty.
Right.
Jesus will give you water that springs eternal in your soul, and you will never thirst again. It's encouragement when you're down. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world. That's Jesus.
Amen.
It tells you what to do when you get angry. Be angry, but sin not. You see, there's nothing wrong with being angry sometimes. It's what you do in response to that anger that matters. It calms the storms in your life. Like Jesus, you can learn to speak to your storm and tell it, peace, be still. It shows you God's love when you feel no one loves you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to die for your sins and mine. The Word of God, it gives you joy when all you feel is sorrow. You must understand that even though you have not seen Jesus, your faith can allow you to have unspeakable joy. You'll have so much joy you won't even understand why you're happy. Other people will look at you wondering why you're not somewhere in a corner with your head covered, but instead you're able to stand because you're standing on the Word of God. It gives you hope when you feel all hope is gone. David said it this way in Psalm 52:9, for what you have done, I will always praise you in the presence of your faithful people. And I will hope in your name, for your name is good. It lets you know you're never alone. God said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. It will protect you. The Word of God is sharper than a two-edged sword. I'm trying to tell you, stay in the pack. Stay with the pack. Don't let the devourer separate you out. Don't make it easier for him to destroy you. Because let me tell you something. When the Word says Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy, it means that literally. That's not an exaggeration. Satan is the author of lies, and he will tell you whatever he needs to separate you from other Christians. The lie is no one wants you there. Remember what that woman said to you? She's probably still talking about you. But the truth is that woman has problems of her own and is probably not thinking about you. And even if she is, you live a life that's pleasing to the Lord, and perhaps you can be an encouragement and an example for her. The lie is, you need to get ready for work or school tomorrow, and you can only do it in the hour and a half we spend here. But the truth is, you've had the whole week, all day Saturday, and the rest of the day Sunday to get it done. It does not have to be done during this time and the time that you should be at church. Giving in to those lies has just made you an easy prey for Satan. I'm trying to get you to the other side of through. I'm trying to get you to your blessing. So stay with me. So Satan is in heaven talking to God, and God gives Satan a character reference on Job. Now that's a reference when God says something about you.
Amen.
And here's what God said about Job. Have you noticed my servant Job? He is the finest man in all the earth. He is blameless, a man of complete integrity. He fears God and stays away from evil. Now, wouldn't you like God to give that kind of character reference about you?
Amen.
Amen? Well, Satan says, sure, he's all that because you blessed him and protected him. If you took all this stuff, he'd curse you to your face. God said, try him, but don't attack his body. So Satan goes away, and the next thing Job knows, a messenger comes with the news the oxen were plowing with the donkeys feeding beside them. And the Sabians raided, stole all the animals, and killed all the farmhands. Before he finished his report, the next messenger comes in with this news. The fire of God has fallen from heaven and burned up your sheep and all the shepherds. Before he finished his report, the next messenger comes in with this news. Three bands of Chaldean raiders have stolen your camels and killed your servants. Before he finished his report, the next messenger comes in with this news. Your sons and daughters were feasting in the oldest brother's home, suddenly a powerful wind swept in from the wilderness and hit the house on all sides. The house collapsed and all your children are dead. Now, is there anyone here who still thinks they have a bad life and they don't think things could get any worse? Say this, Job, my problem isn't so bad. This is not to say that what you're dealing with isn't real or rough or the worst thing you've ever been through. It's not to minimize what you're going through, but it is meant to put a little perspective on what you're experiencing. Say it with me, Job,
my problem isn't so bad.
It was a test, and here was Job's answer. He stood up, he grieved, he tore his robe, he fell to the ground, and he worshiped God. Even in trouble, we have to, like Job, learn to worship God. It's a test of your faith. Will you pass your test or will you need a do-over? Job passed his test. He didn't sin against God like Satan thought he would, but that was just part one. Once again, Satan went to God with the other angels, and there was another conversation that went pretty much like the first. Satan is roaming around. God brings Job to the forefront again. But this time, Satan says, skin for skin, a man will do anything to save his own life. So God says, go for it. That's not what it said. That's my translation. But don't kill him. So Satan went again and inflicted Job with blistering sores that covered him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. His own wife is now challenging him, and she says, are you still trying to maintain your integrity? Curse God and die. To which Job responded, woman, you sound foolish. This right there is why you've got to have your own faith, why you've got to be able to encourage yourself, because sometimes those closest to you will give you bad advice. Then for 34 chapters, there's a dialogue between Job and his friends about what's going on, why this is happening, and back and forth of you did something, and no, I didn't, and you must have, and you don't know what you're talking about. Then Job gets beside himself and begins to question God. Then we get to chapter 38, and finally, God has had enough. He speaks from a whirlwind. Now, when God starts speaking to you out of your complaining, watch out. God answers Job with some questions of his own. Who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorant words? Brace yourself like a man, because I have some questions for you, and you must answer them. You can't question God. He's our Father, and He wants us to understand. In fact, Proverbs 4:7, Solomon tells us this, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. So God doesn't mind if you ask questions, but there is a limit. And I, for one, don't ever want God to ask me, who is this that questions my wisdom? Amen? I'm not going to go into all the questions God asked Job, but suffice to say there were some tough questions to which Job finally responded, I had only heard about you before, but now I have seen you with my own eyes. I take back everything I said, and I sit in dust and ashes to show my repentance. Job said, I'm sorry, God. I'm sorry. Job stopped. He thought about it and decided, I need to back up here a minute. Job had lost his perspective for just a minute. Sometimes when you're in the midst of a storm, you can lose your focus for just a minute. You can forget who you are and who God is. But here's what I want you to know. Here's what I want you to get down in your spirit, and it's our text for today. It's coming from Job 42, verses 10 through 13. After all that had gone on, this verse says, after Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes and gave him twice as much as he had before. All his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought on him, and each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, and 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys. And he also had 7 sons and 3 daughters. Job went through an unimaginable thing. He lost not one, not two, not three, but 10 children. And he lost all his material possessions all on the same day. Say it with me. Job,
my problem
isn't so bad. Yes, he lost all of that, but our scripture text is why we keep going. It's why we never give up, never give in, why we trust God no matter what it looks like, no matter what anyone says. It's why we must be able to encourage ourselves in the Lord. We hang on to get to the other side of through. When you know that you know that you know that God is your Savior and Redeemer, that He loves you and is looking out for you, then you can pray for those who are trying to tell you what is happening to you is your own fault. You may have folks around you who are as wrong as 2 left feet, but you pray for them anyway, and here's what God can do for you. After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes and gave him twice as much as he had before. Look at God. He didn't just give it back. He gave him twice as much as he had before. Now remember when we began, Job was already the richest man in Uz, and now God has given him back double what Satan has destroyed. God can give you double for your trouble. God owns everything. What is that little bit that you have to him in the big picture? David says it this way in Psalm 8, when I consider the heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? Who are we that God even thinks about us? What God can bless us with is more than we could ask or think. And who are we that he even thinks about us anyway? Well, I've got news for you, just in case you didn't know. God loves you more than anyone else. In fact, he loves you so much, he gave his only begotten son to save your life. When God blesses you and gives you back what Satan took, remember those who may have been there before and while you were going through. The next verse says, all his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in the house. They comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought on him, and each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. So not only did these people come with words of comfort and consolation, but they didn't come empty-handed. Each one gave him a piece of silver and a gold ring. Not or, but and. God had already given Job double for his trouble, but he used men to bless him even more. The next verse is where we get the words you often hear us say in the song that we love, your latter will be greater than your past. After all is said and done, the best is yet to come. Your latter will be greater than the rest. That's verse 12, and it says, the Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. Y'all, he gave him double for his trouble. So Job now has 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 teams of oxen, and 1,000 female donkeys. But God didn't stop there. He also gave Job 7 more sons and 3 more daughters. Now we all know that children can't be replaced, but Job went from his lineage being gone to being fully restored. But God didn't stop there. Job lived 140 years after that, living to see 4 generations of his children and grandchildren. Then he died an old man who had lived a long, full life. So what's the lesson in all of this? Stay faithful to God. When everything seems to be falling apart around you, worship the Lord. When you can't do anything else and you fall into your knees, you're in the perfect position to praise God. When you don't know what else to do, put a praise on it. We are to love the Lord thy God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's the first and great commandment that God gave us. Nowhere in that commandment did it say to only do it when things are going great, when it looks good, when you're happy, when you're satisfied, when the bills are paid, when your car is new and it's not breaking down. You see, whether you realize it or not, whether you acknowledge it or not, every day you wake up is a great blessing from God. Every day you wake up, open your eyes and see anything, it's a blessing from God. Every day you put your feet on the floor and you're able to stand up on them, it's a blessing from God. Every day you're able to hug someone you love, it's a blessing from God. Every day you're able to open your mouth and the words come out and you can speak unhindered, it's a blessing from God. Every day you can give God the praise, because there are many that are out there that can't praise God. There are countries that don't allow them to praise God. There are places that we've been that don't even allow a Bible in the country. There are places where you can't preach, teach, hear the word of God. So every day that we come, every day that we are able to, is a blessing from God. Things may be rough right now. Your life may not be looking so good right now. Money may be a little tight right now. You may be a little bit lonely right now. You may not have a lot of homework right now. You may not have as many friends as you want right now. But to get to the other side of through, to get to your blessing, you have to keep living. To get to the other side of through, you have to keep moving. To get to the other side of through, you have to keep pushing. To get to the other side of through, you have to keep praying. To get to the other side of through, you have to keep praising the Lord. To get to the other side of through, you have to keep worshiping. To get to the other side of through, you have to keep loving God the same way he loved you. Even before you were born, you see, even before time began, God knew you would be here in this place at this time hearing this message. He knew that you were lost. He knew we were on our way to hell. He knew we would need a Savior, and he provided one in his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus was not a plan B. He was there before time began, and he knew we need him to save us from ourselves and save us from the enemy, whose only goal in life is to destroy us, to destroy our soul. Saints, we're at war. We are warring for eternal souls. Eternity is a long time. In fact, it's forever. And that is the ultimate side of through. Your blessing is on the other side of through. And that's where not only our desire should be, but we've got to strive to get there. When you strive for something, you're doing something to make it happen. To strive is active, not passive. The other side of through should be a desire. Because who wouldn't want to be in the arms of God forever, safe from all hurt, harm, and danger? Hallelujah! The other side of through. Let us stand. God. We want to get to the other side of through. I don't care where you are right now. The other side of through is where you're trying to get to. The other side of through is what we should all be looking forward to. The other side of through. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you, if you never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the other side of through for you is not going to be pretty. It's not going to be good. But I want you to get there with those who have accepted Jesus as a Lord and Savior.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Jesus is knocking at the door of your heart. Will you let him in?
Yes, yes.
If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, today is a good day.
Good day.
It's a good time to give God your heart.
Yes, Lord.
If you don't know him, the pardon of your sins, come right now.
Right now.
And give